Before starting the video today, I'd like to thank you for your support. I appreciate the comments and the messages. This channel is still a work in progress, but the response has been good, so I am very grateful. Please keep supporting, and if you like these videos, please share them with the ones who would find them relevant. Thank you again. Let's start the video now. Today we will learn about Eigen Decomposition, that is representing a matrix in terms of its eigenvalues and eigenvectors. What are eigenvalues and eigenvectors? We'll see to that too. And the spectral theorem. These topics are important, so watch the video till the end. Remember that the span of a vector is the set of all possible vectors that can be obtained by stretching, shrinking, or flipping the vector. Therefore, the span of the basis vectors I hat and j hat of a 2D space are the x and y axes respectively. No matter how much it stretches or shrinks, it is always on the same line. We also learned that a linear transformation can be represented by a matrix, the rows of which represent the coordinates to which the basis vectors move after the transformation is applied. Let's reset the effect of the transformation. Try adding a few more vectors and applying the matrix again. Notice that most of the vectors are knocked off their span after the transformation. But a few special vectors, like the basis vector along the x-axis and the yellow vector, stay on their span, meaning that the effect of the matrix has on such a vector is just to stretch or shrink it, like a scalar multiplication. There is no rotation. Notice that I hat is stretched by a factor of 3 and the yellow vector is stretched by a factor of 2. Now, the way linear transformations work, any other vector on the x-axis is also stretched by a factor of 3 and any other vector on the span of the yellow vector is stretched by a factor of 2 and hence remains on its own span. Any other vector just gets knocked off its span. We saw this earlier. These special vectors that remain on their own span during the transformation are called the eigenvectors of the transformation. And each eigenvector has associated with it what's called an eigenvalue, which is just the factor by which it is stretched or shrunk during the transformation. Now trivially, if a vector x is an eigenvector for a matrix, then so is any scaled version of it. So, when one talks about eigenvectors, they are always referring to the unit eigenvectors. For each special vector y resulting from Ax, that is, just a scaled version of the input vector x, we say that Ax equals lambda x, where lambda is a scalar value and represents the factor by which the vector is scaled. This equation can be interpreted to mean that the matrix A is merely stretching or shrinking the vector x. There is no rotation. Notice that if you find the values of lambda that satisfy the equation Ax equals lambda x, you'll have the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors of matrix A. Let's see how. Since we have matrix vector multiplication on the left hand side and scalar vector multiplication on the right hand side, it is a little awkward to work with this equation. So we multiply the right hand side with an identity matrix. Why the identity matrix? Remember, in our matrix video, we saw that multiplication with an identity matrix preserves the original vector. Therefore, this does not affect the equations. Now we can work with this equation to get the expression A minus lambda I times x equals 0. Now there are two possible solutions. One is where x equals 0, that is the vector itself is 0, which isn't what we are looking for. We want non-zero eigenvectors. So let's see the other possibility, which is that the determinant of the matrix A minus lambda I is 0. You know what happens when the determinant of a matrix is 0. If you don't, Watch my previous video on determinants after you watch this video. For now, you just need to know that if determinant of a matrix is 0, then the transformation associated with that matrix squishes the space into a lower dimension. For our matrix A, A minus lambda I can be written as this matrix. Now we need to find a value of lambda for which the determinant of A minus lambda I equals 0. So let's equate the determinant to 0 and solve the expression to get lambda equals 3 and 2. Therefore, matrix A has eigenvalues 3 and 2. Also notice that the product of eigenvalues equals the determinant of the matrix. Now let's substitute the eigenvalues into A minus lambda I and find the eigenvectors of the matrix A. The matrix A minus lambda I squeezes the space onto a line. Solving for lambda equals 2, notice that the solutions are all the vectors on the diagonal line spanned by minus 1, 1. I hope you might have already guessed the eigenvector when lambda equals 3, but I recommend that you solve for it and comment down the eigenvectors you find. Doing it firsthand is the best way to learn, believe me. You can watch 1000 videos and still not get it, but if you try it on your own, you'll see that it's not that hard. So try computing the eigenvectors for lambda equals 3. Now before moving on to the next topic, here is a thought experiment for you. If matrix A scales the space by 3, what are the eigenvalues and the eigenvectors? It should be easy to answer that the only eigenvalue is 3, but every vector in the plane gets to be an eigenvector with an eigenvalue of 3. One more, okay? If matrix A rotates the space by 90 degrees, what are the eigenvalues and eigenvectors? Comment down your answers. Eigen decomposition is used to decompose a matrix into eigenvectors and eigenvalues. Eigen decomposition appears repeatedly in machine learning, sometimes as a key step in the learning algorithm itself. Also, Google's infamous PageRank algorithm uses eigenvector corresponding to the maximal eigenvalue of a matrix A to determine the rank of a page for search. Decomposing a matrix in terms of its eigenvalues and eigenvectors gives valuable insights into the properties of the matrix. Imagine a matrix can be summed up to just a multiplication of a scalar and a vector. How cool is that? Suppose a matrix A is a square matrix with n linearly independent eigenvectors x1 so on till xn and corresponding eigenvalues lambda1 so on till lambda n. Let's define a new matrix Q to be a collection of these eigenvectors, such as each column of Q is an eigenvector of A. Now AQ can be written as, which can be rewritten as, since AX equals lambda X. This means AQ equals to Q lambda, where lambda denotes the diagonal matrix of eigenvalues. Since the matrix Q is invertible, do you know why? Comment down, it's easy. So since the matrix Q is invertible, we can multiply both sides of the equation with Q inverse. The takeaway from this expression is that the matrix Q is a square matrix such that the ith column of Q is the eigenvector of A, corresponding to the eigenvalue in the ith row of lambda. Any full rank square matrix can be factorized in this way. Now let's understand eigen decomposition geometrically. The column on the left shows the space transformed by A. The column on the right shows the same transformation arrived at by sequentially multiplying with Q inverse, lambda and Q components. Let's apply matrix A. Notice the transformation by A in the space in the left column. Now I need your full attention on the space in the right column. Note how the first transformation Q inverse X mostly rotates the space into an orientation that is then scaled by matrix lambda in the second step. And in the final step, the transformation matrix Q, being an inverse of the first step, reverses the rotation from the first step. Notice this in the next example. Now let's see the effect of a matrix for which one of the elements of the diagonal matrix lambda becomes almost zero. Notice how the space gets squashed in that direction. The last topic for today is the spectral theorem. For real symmetric matrices, Eigen decomposition is guaranteed and is also special. The spectral theorem guarantees the Eigen decomposition of symmetric matrices. For symmetric matrices, we know that Q inverse equals Q transpose. Therefore, the Eigen decomposition expression that we deduced earlier can be written as. In other words, this states that the Eigen decomposition of a symmetric matrix leads to an orthogonal matrix. Let's see this geometrically, just like we did for the Eigen decomposition, but with symmetry constraints on A. Let's apply matrix A to the space in the left column. Now check out the first step in the right column, Q transpose X. Since Q is orthogonal and so is its inverse, there is no stretching or shrinking in the first step, only rotation. Any stretching or shrinking is happening in the second step, AQ trans. Also, the eigenvectors are always orthonormal in such cases. Eigen decomposition is one of the approaches to finding the inverse of a matrix. If a matrix can be eigen decomposed, then finding its inverse is quite easy. Using the properties of inverses, we can write the eigen decomposition expression as. We know from previous discussion that the inverse of the orthogonal matrix Q is computationally cheap and it always exists. Since lambda is a diagonal matrix, its inverse, lambda inverse, can also be easily computed. It is merely another diagonal matrix whose entries are the reciprocals of the values along the diagonal of the original matrix. Now here is the interesting part. If any of the eigenvalues is zero, then the diagonal lambda is not invertible, since its determinant is zero, and by consequence, A is also not invertible. That is it for today. Thanks for your time. Have a nice day.